I'm just going to jump right in because we have a lot to cover and not a lot of time. So our topic today is innovation in the space race era and beyond. So in 1957, as many of you know, Sputnik was launched by the Soviet Union. It's their first satellite, little thing about the size of a basketball. Went into Earth orbit. All it did was beep and take some very rudimentary temperature measurements. But it scared the dickens out of the West, and people were just thinking, oh my God, the Russians are ahead of us, what are we gonna do? You all remember this. It was a big moment, and the Western powers went nuts. And thus began the space race. NASA was formed shortly thereafter, had a mandate to get a satellite up very quickly, struggled to do that. We had a mandate to get humans in space very quickly, we struggled to do that a bit. The Soviet Union beat us to that. And as all this is going on, with a grand total of 15 minutes of suborbital flight time by Alan Shepard in the first Mercury mission, President Kennedy said, guys, we're going to the moon and we're going to do it by the end of the decade. Have at it. Now, this was not a great interest in science or exploration on his part. This was a geopolitical mandate to show the world that the United States and the Western powers were the leaders in technology, education, engineering, and science. Well, I think, and you would know this, there were probably a lot of slack jaws that afternoon when that announcement was made because we didn't really know how we were going to get there. Some things we didn't even know what we needed to know to start to how to get there. Questions in metallurgy, questions in rocket engine design. All this stuff was brand new. So innovation doesn't, the word innovation doesn't even really begin to cover what we were talking about in this era. We had to invent this entire industry based on some very rudimentary knowledge inherited from the Germans in World War II and the earliest efforts in both the US and the Soviet Union for intercontinental ballistic missiles to invent the program that would let these gentlemen go to the moon. So I think my first question is, we have this post-World War II competition between the two superpowers as a non-shooting war to, quote, conquer the heavens, unquote. And Kennedy looking for some goal that we can actually beat the Russians at, because according to his advisors, it wasn't going to be a space station, they could do that first. It wasn't going to be looping the moon, they could probably do that first. But landing on the moon and coming safely home was complex enough that we had a good chance, and as it turned out, that worked out to be the case. We managed to do it. So I think if you look at that era and you look at Kennedy's speech, there were two of them, one to Congress and one to the public, and you really listen to what's being said, there's a number of things, and Tony writes about this quite a bit in his book and the articles he does in a magazine, I edit. This program that he laid out to land on the moon by the end of the decade was a clear goal, it was a concise goal, it was bold and daring, it was competitive, which seems to be something that Americans like, it was well-funded, which is important, but perhaps most importantly, it was time limited. So I'd like to ask you gentlemen, because you were there, all I do is write about it, you were there, what parts of these factors do you think were the most important that made this achievable in that period of time, and how can we relate that to what we're trying to do now? And why don't we start right here with Jerry?
A number of things happened that it was very fortunate. For one thing, in World War II, we built in this country a great aviation industry. And much of that aviation know-how was moved right into the space program. It had to go higher and faster and different materials. But we had a base of people that, for one thing, made it work. Now, Rod mentioned that when Kennedy said, we're going to go to the moon, do it in this decade, I think there were a lot of people, I know I was one, that said, really? You think we could do that? But we had another advantage in that we were primarily pretty young people. In fact, I was one of the oldest guys in the control center because I'd served 4 years of active duty in the Air Force, and I was 29, and I was one of the old guys. We had guys 22, 23, right out of college. We've been told to do this. We've been given the keys to the car, essentially, and told we could drive it. And we didn't know we couldn't do it, so we just set about to get it done. And we had support from both sides of the aisle, Republican and Democrat. We went through three presidents in that time, and the support never wavered. And that's what we've lost in a way that we don't have now. We can't seem to get behind an issue like this one and make it happen. I've probably said enough. I'll let these other guys.
Yeah. I think you can track the ups and the downs and the successes and the failures in a space program based on who the leadership was in Washington. When JFK was probably the greatest booster and sponsor of the space program of any president we've had. But I think there's a lot more to him making that pronouncement than there was just a competition with the Russians. Back in the late 50s and early 60s, there was a lot of unrest in this country. We'd had the Bay of Pigs. We'd had a bunch of other things happen. And I think this was also an attempt on his part to bring the country together, because it was a goal that everybody in the country understood and supported. And I think that was very important. But I think there's also a hidden component in all of that, which to me is the key to why the Apollo program was successful and why this country has been so successfully in the market since then, and that is the development of technology that it took to go to the moon, do it safely, and bring people back. We developed back in the late 50s and early 60s things called solid-state components, solid-state devices, and they were based on silicon chips that were developed back in the late 50s by the Defense Advanced Research Products Agency in this country. Those silicon chips now are in every cell phone, every MRI, every television, everything that we live with today involves the use of those kind of chips, and nobody else had them except in this country. And they were a big help in getting us to the moon and back. So to me, the development of technology in the program is almost as important as sending somebody to the moon. It's the technology to get you there that's important.
The only thing I'd add, at the time, career-wise, I was a test pilot for NASA. I was at Lewis Research Center, in Cleveland, and then I moved on to Edwards, where the X-15 program was going on. And so my only knowledge, if you will, or association anyway, with space was rocket engine testing that was being done at Lewis. And, of course, the X-15 rocket ship was in play at Edwards. So I have to say, when they made that announcement, I just said, this is a big step. I mean, just like Al said, can we really pull this off? Because I had no knowledge base at all of the space activities and even what had been done up to that time, starting with Mercury was just getting underway. So I, other than that, the thing mentioned, of course, is the alliance that we've had and support from the president on through. I thought the mission itself, the description of going to the moon, it was intriguing enough that we had, I call it probably the strongest grassroots support we've had in a space program since. People could relate to that, and it was pretty spectacular to think about. And I think that was another thing that also, if they took surveys and whatever with the political pay attention to, I think it was doing pretty good even in that time frame, for the most part, to part of the program to get to the moon. So I think that helped as well to keep this this assurance.
First, I would like to thank having such a nice crowd here of people that are enthusiastic about this. It's, at least for me, it's pretty rare. And I'd also like to give you a little bit of a different perspective on the Russians and them being ahead of us, if you will. And this may or may not be accepted by my friends who haven't heard me say this, but when we set out to go to the, even before we set out to go to the moon, when Alan Shepard got his flight, that was like a month after they had sent Yuri Gagarin up. And that Yuri Gagarin, it was up and around the world once. I guarantee you the Russians did not have control of that spacecraft. He's along for the ride. We had a different set of program going from the beginning. And as a matter of fact, since there was a delay between the Mercury program and the Apollo program, which was the program that was going to go to the moon, we filled that delay with the Gemini program. And that Gemini program was not all that expensive compared to Apollo. It was a fairly short term, but they, over a period of 2 years with 12 launches, they did EVA, rendezvous, docking, and controlled. They controlled the steering on the reentry. So by the time we finished the Gemini program, which was before we got a chance to fly on Apollo, but they were getting Apollo started, we had cut out all of the things that we could possibly have thought of at the time as the Russians being ahead. So it's not a popular position today, but by the time we got to that point, technically, we had regained, and we're back, in my opinion, we're back in the first position for getting man into space and back.
I just want to make a little comment about how important Al Shepard's flight was. I was flying in a fighter squadron in Washington, D.C., out of Andrews Air Force Base, and all the pilots were kind of milling around the pilot's lounge, which was really our source of coffee back in those days, and we were watching a television, and it was counting down to Al Shepard making his launch, that very important first launch. All of a sudden, over the radio, we get a call from our aircraft maintenance officer, who's up test flying one of our F-102s, and he's having a problem with it, and he's got to come back in and make an emergency landing, and he can't get the gear down. So he's going to have to land without the landing gear on his airplane at the same time that Al Shepard's getting ready to take off. So we had a choice to make. Did we sit there and watch Al Shepard go, or did we get our marshmallows and go to the runway for Major Stenger when he was going to land his airplane? And you obviously know which ones we did. Yeah. We collected our marshmallows.
Test pilots, you gotta love them. So just to shift direction a little tiny bit here, we're almost as far from that first moon landing now as that was from the first flight of the Wright brothers. In a few years, it'll be equidistant, which just blows my mind. There's commentary you could say about how much we've advanced since then, you know, was the space race, the picking the low-hanging fruit and so forth. But my point here is, when I look back on what you guys are working with and what you accomplished, the further I get from that, the more it's almost hard to believe it ever happened, based on the technology you had at that time. It was remarkable, and as has been said by a number of people and requoted, it's almost as if they reached into the 21st century and brought Apollo back to the 1960s. So my question is, with that kind of innovation comes a certain amount of acceptance of risk. And I think that equation has changed over the years. I think NASA got very sensitized to risk reduction after the Challenger explosion and then Columbia. So, and there's a bigger discussion we had about private space flight, but for now, let's just talk about NASA moving ahead. What is, in your opinions, having put your lives on the line, what is an acceptable level of risk to encourage rapid innovation and accomplishment in space flight?
These guys.
You want me to start? Oh, okay.
One of the guys that sat on top of a rocket.
Thank you, Jerry.
With liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen under.
I think the level of risk that you will accept is dependent on the goal that you have. If I'm walking across the street, I don't want much risk. But if I'm going to the moon, I'm willing to accept almost any risk. I know as far as my crew was concerned, we decided amongst ourselves before we ever left the launch pad that we would accept dying on the flight because what we were doing was more important than we were. Now, I think there's a whole series of levels of goals and risk in between those two. So I think it's really a function of how important the goal is. On the other hand, I think we need to be rather logical in the goals that we we establish. So what are our next goals going to be, and what is the level of risk that we're willing to take? I think Mars is a very risky thing. I think there's no question about it. It's going to be a year and a half flight, and a lot of things could happen in a year and a half. So I think the level of risk is going up proportionate to that goal, and that's just an intermediate goal. I mean, I don't want anybody to think that Mars is a destination. It's only another step on the way.
Now, I'd have to say the confidence I had, obviously, with the possibility, as it turned out, things might not go right. You considered that. I had a designee, Jerry Carr, that I had to my house before I flew, that Jerry knew where important papers were. And he was the guy that was going to take care of my wife, should I not get back on that flight. And that was kind of customary. I don't know, Walt, same way in Marine fighter squadrons, I normally had a best friend kind of designee in the same way to worry about the family, should one day I not get back from a flight. So, you know, there's that inherent risk of that. But what gave me the confidence was being a part of the whole process of getting these things ready. I mean, I've had some people naively think maybe I sat back and played AC-DC until the rocket was ready, and they called me up and said, come on out, it's time to fly. Well, it wasn't that way. You were involved throughout the, I wasn't in Apollo, I came in late in the program, but I was on shuttle through the whole design phase, through the whole design development phase, participated in all design reviews, wrote RIDs, which are discrepancies on the design. So you were intimately involved in what this thing was going to look like and act like and how it was going to perform. Then you would test it. You tested in the vehicle, the actual hardware, throughout in the plant, in the factories, and then when they were shipped to the Kennedy, special tests there that you were involved in. So you got a lot of confidence in the hardware and software. So that gave you added confidence. Also, I'll have to tell you that we had people, a great talent base in the program, a huge talent base, that were highly motivated to do it right. I've encountered many, many people one guy at Grumman, I was in the vehicle one night that early in the morning testing. This young fellow was from Brooklyn, and he was changing some wiring, and he leaned over me one time. He said, sir, he said, I don't know why you want to go to the moon. I wouldn't want to go. But I'll tell you, I'm doing the best job I can to make sure this thing is right till you get there and back. And I think that was kind of a feeling I felt most of the workers that were on the program throughout the U.S., and there were a lot of them, over 400,000 at peak of Apollo, that felt that way, that this was important enough and they were going to do the best they could to make sure everything was right.
I would say that the most obvious thing to me these days, this day and age, is how our public at large actually has changed. And back in those days, the early 60s, late 50s, everybody was a Marine Corps, everybody was a fighter pilot. And the majority of them were also test pilots. And rightly or wrongly, in the squadrons in those days, we thought we could survive over anything. We thought whether we were the best one, most of them, thought they were the best one in that squadron. So you're willing to stick your neck out a little to make that accomplishment. And I'm sure that the Russians that were involved had kind of a similar attitude back in those days. Society and culture has changed over the years. They now try to make everything as safe as they possibly can. And less than half of the people are military pilots. And you could be a military helicopter pilot today. So in my opinion, what made that really in the end a success was the attitude of the people that we had that were participating in that program. We were willing to stick our necks out. And it's a good thing we were. Apollo 7 was the first Apollo mission. Probably nobody out here has the faintest idea that that was the third attempt to have a first Apollo mission there. So I'm just saying our attitude is something that we're going to have to get back to, you know, to whether it's to go back to the moon or even eventually, a couple decades at least from now, go to Mars.
And then you.
Let me put a little management viewpoint. I was fortunate to work with every astronaut from John Glenn all through Apollo, and then later when I came back to Johnson Space Center, I got to deal with a lot of shuttle people. There's one thing about astronauts that I learned in that 25-year span, and that is I didn't think any of them were afraid of dying. They really weren't. What they were afraid of is making an error, screwing up in front of their peers. That drove them to really, really work hard to make sure that they didn't make a mistake. If somebody was going to make one, it was going to be somebody else.
Good observation.
The other thing is, I've been asked before, what was the real job of mission control and all of that structure that was on the ground? And it took me a while to get to it, but in my opinion, our biggest job was to manage risk. We were trying to manage risk to the lowest level we could. But you got to remember something. When you strap into a rocket and you're sitting on probably 6 million pounds of liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen, and hopefully you keep them apart, you are at risk. And no matter what you do, you can't manage risk to zero. So then it becomes Walt's argument, or your argument, maybe Al, what is the risk versus gain? So it becomes a risk versus gain game, which you face in industry, farming, it doesn't make any difference. Sometimes you have to take a risk to get something done. So that's kind of the 20,000 foot view, I think, of what it's like to undertake something like going and landing on the moon. Two really dynamic phases. One is Earth orbit, getting out of it. It's fairly easy comparative to that until you get to the moon, and then you got to land. And so you got these two dynamic phases at the end. We're going to face the same thing going back to the moon. We're going to face the same thing going on to Mars and beyond. I agree that that's just another step. But you need to think about the risk. It is a risky business, much, not too different, but a little, than getting in your airplane and flying. You can't ever drive that risk to zero either. So anyway, that was my...
Jerry, I'll make the point that those involved in the space program around the world are non-political, basically. If you look at the Association of Space Explorers, which encompasses everybody who's flown in space, you'll find people in that association from every country in the world, just about. However, from a personal standpoint, 1 month before my flight, the Russians lost three guys coming back from their space station because of a hatch malfunction, and they were exposed to a vacuum. The United States and Russia at the time were sort of looking at each other and not very friendly. But the space program immediately called us and told us that they had a problem and that they would keep us aware of what they were finding out with that problem, what caused the accident. And as a result of what the Russians told us, we changed the procedures on our flight to always wear a spacesuit if there was a possibility of opening a hatch anywhere. And that was based on what the Russians told us. Even though our countries were in conflict at the time, those in the space program recognized the risk to everybody, and they were all willing to help each other out mitigate that risk.
glad you mentioned that, because I've got an internationalism question, but I'm going to save that for a second before I go there. So you all worked in an era when spaceflight was a government-supported endeavor. Of course, the spacecraft were largely built by contractors, aerospace contractors under traditional arrangements. Things have changed. We just saw the launch of the Falcon Heavy, which a crazy billionaire decided to develop and fly on his own. And it was a remarkable success once so far. So we're in this new era where we have still NASA operating at a much lower budget level, about a tenth of what it was at its height in the 60s, and probably doing easily 10 times more in terms of diversity of missions. So that's a huge challenge. You've got the entrepreneurs like Musk and Bezos and others who are building their own rocket systems, which are coming in and hopefully supporting what NASA does at a much lower cost and with competition. And then you've got international players, which I have another question about. Where do you think, and I really have been looking forward to asking you four guys this question, do I need to get closer to this? Because you have a knowledge base that is really unique. And experience base really unique. Where is the sweet spot for these operators that gives us the maximum bang for our buck in which we can get things achieved quickly, efficiently, and as safely as possible?
Well, I personally feel like we don't have the same attitude towards competition in our industry that we used to at that time. And the costs of things today, much, much greater than what it was then. For example, the entire Apollo program, the original proposal, I think it was $20 billion. When we finished the program, it had gone over cost all the way up to $25 billion, which is closer to a one-year budget today for it. But if you convert that money today from what it was back in the 1960s, I think we're talking about $140 billion, $150 billion. So the costs are high. So you got to be willing to do that. Not to mention the fact that our culture and our society changes every year, too. It's increasing tremendously. So we spend a lot more money on a lot of other things that keeps us from having, you know, the money that we're in those days we were willing to do to go to the moon. The Russians, they cover things a little bit better. They charge us only $80 million for take a guy up there for this ride to report. So that attitude is changing for us. It takes a big commitment, and it also takes an efficient organization. NASA today is, well, now they're 55, 60 years old. Back in the beginning, everybody was oriented towards what the goal was to do that. And then as a government agency ages, it gets less efficient. They do more objectives they've added into it. And so it's, you don't have the same economics as we had then. So we have to find a way to get back to it. We also have to continue to be realistic on how long it takes to get some of these places today, because we have folks, especially the private industry out there today, trying to sell on a basis that doesn't even come close to being sensible on, landing on Mars in 2024. Do you want to go along for that ride? So I'm just saying,
first one,
we have got to get realistic and quit being just socialistically changing as time goes on.
Who's next?
Well, I just going back to NASA's mission. NASA's mission to me is exploration. So to me, the way the commercial guys fit in is depending on the architecture of how you're going to get back to the moon or create this lunar colony or Mars for that matter. If there's pieces of that architecture that involve just, say, getting up to low Earth orbit or even transit to the moon back and forth, the real exploration is done after you get to the surface, be it on the moon or on Mars. So any part of that architecture that the commercial guys could fill, say getting a low Earth orbit with either people and supplies, clearly it's, NASA's not meant to be a truck driver to haul stuff up and down the low Earth orbit. That's not exploration. So if the commercial guys economically fit into that, I think surely that's what you use and take advantage of.
Okay, I think we need to understand the terms about these things that we're talking about, and I'm not sure we all do. We're talking about private industry building spacecraft to go somewhere. We're talking about entrepreneurial motivation, you know, entrepreneurial work to do that. In my opinion, in my mind, there's only one entrepreneur out there. Only one. That's Jeff Bezos. Why? Because he is the only one building spacecraft that's putting his own money in it. Everybody else is dependent on somebody else to fund what they're doing. SpaceX, Elon, God bless him, he's doing some wonderful things, but he is supported by the government. He gets his funding from the government. Boeing doing the same thing with their spacecraft. They're getting funded by the government. Jeff Bezos is the only one who's putting his own money where his mouth is. And I think we have to be careful when we talk about private industry doing these kinds of things, because I don't see any difference between SpaceX and North American Rockwell 40 years ago. They're both getting paid by the government to do what they did.
I'll ask
it may have been a lot more expensive back then because the bureaucracy is not as efficient, but basically it was the same thing.
Well, Al? Hey,
well, you're a little bit wrong.
I'm always a little bit wrong.
Elon spent his own money
to
develop the Falcon. And he flew two or three of those Falcons. Then they moved to the 9, the Falcon 9 that they've got today. That's because it's got 9 engines on it. They moved to the Falcon. He started that development on his own, and then the government came to him and said, let us see if there's a way we can work together here, because they didn't have any way to get to low Earth orbit after the shuttle.
You think he could have done it if they hadn't stepped in?
I don't know. But
well, he did raise $100 million also of private investment.
Well, and he's got some investors.
Yeah.
It's not the thing about Jeff is that Jeff's own money. I mean, it's out of his pocket. And I heard him say 2 years ago at the Space Foundation thing in Colorado Springs, they said, how are you funding? Somebody asked him a question, how are you funding this? And Jeff said, I spend $1 billion, I sell $1 billion of stock a year in Amazon and put it into Blue Origin. So bottom line, here's what I think. I think the commercial guys have shown enough zeal and enough expertise, frankly, that I think they're going to own as much as what Fred is saying, they're going to own the domain of low Earth orbit, and they probably should. It's a hauling job. And that leaves NASA then to really get back to exploration, looking down the line. But remember, when NASA puts out money to go back to the moon or to Gateway or to Mars, whatever they're going to do, they're going to buy it from American industry. Nobody at NASA builds rockets. Mm-hmm. It's all their contractors. So in a way, we all come back to the commercial sector providing the hardware and the software that we need to get to outer space or somewhere in between. But I think the commercial guys are going to own low Earth orbit. I think that's good. I think it gets the focus off of that for NASA. Let them look out.
Well, Al, if we make the presentation to him, he may give you a ride on one of those 5 seats in his command module, total module on it. The attitude is different when it comes to exploration, in my opinion. And not to mention the fact that they have not been realistic about what the cost is to do something like go to Mars. They haven't even come close on neither the schedule or the cost of what it's going to take then. And you will find some people in today's society who are perfectly willing to stick their necks out to do it, and that you need that to do it, to go to those new places.
The worst thing about the Mars mission is that we got a lot of problems that we haven't solved yet to get there. One of it is radiation, and that they are wrestling with that, because once you, if you tried to go to Mars in the command and service module, you'd probably not be cancer-free. There's just too much radiation. Same thing happens on Mars' surface. They've got an atmosphere there. It's mostly CO2, so you can't breathe it. But they don't have the shielding that our planet has. Our magnetosphere is actually what protects mostly from radiation. And by the way, the radiation risk isn't, I just learned this, guys, isn't, the doctors are not so worried so much about it. You're going into convulsions and more like an atomic nuclear weapon might do to you. It's that it ups the cancer risk. You probably make it back okay, but then in the next few years, you'll probably see a deterioration. So it's a interesting problem. There's other problems, but that's the big one. And so we're not even ready to go to Mars. We don't have the technology yet to shield it and do it right.
Jerry, what's funny about that, I've been asked hundreds of times, what kind of a crew should we send to Mars? And I always look, whoever's asking the question, I look them in the eye and I say, me. Hmm. Send me. Why send you? You're an old guy. You did that 40 years ago, blah, blah, blah. And I say, that's exactly why I should be on that flight. I'm an old guy, okay? Things happen when you get older, or things don't happen when you get older, that are very different from the way you were when you were 29 years old. And I'm just thinking about a year and a half flight in a small spacecraft, size of a Volkswagen Beetle, and you got three people sitting there, and if they're all 29, I guarantee you, before too long, somebody's going to be getting some pretty bright ideas about something, right? But I say, hey, send me. I'm an old guy. I'm very comfortable sitting and watching TV all day. So, and if radiation gets you, who cares? I'm an old guy. I've lived a great life. I can go any day, and no mistake about it. It would be great.
So I can see a great branding deal between SpaceX and Barco Lounger now, with you three guys in there and your remotes going,
Al,
I can't get NFL today.
Al, I have to tell you that what they can do then is they can get control of the CO2 that we put out. So, and if they do that fast enough, we can go to Mars so we can survive.
Okay, guys, it's nap time on the spacecraft, right? So, just to steer back to innovation for a moment, we do seem as a country to innovate very well under pressure on a timeline and with a certain amount of competition, whether it's internal or external, which brings me to the question of China. Back in the space race days, we didn't really cooperate with the Soviet Union in manned space flight until before the Apollo-Soyuz test project, but on the robotic side, we were actually cooperating with them in the mid-60s. We're beginning to have conversations at NASA with the Chinese about cooperating on the robotic side, because the stakes are a little lower. What do you all think about cooperation or competition, or perhaps co-opetition, if I may use that word, moving ahead? Is China a partner? Is China a competitor? They get to decide their budgets and their programs 10 and 15 years in advance, and they just march. And we don't get to do that, so it puts us in an interesting position. What do you think?
I've just had some brushing up against that issue. And it came through the aerospace medicine side of things that I won't get into. But, right now, we are not allowed to work with Chinese. It is a restriction placed by the Congress. We can't do it. We're making some breakthroughs through the aerospace medicine side. They have finally started publishing some stuff that they've gotten from their astronauts, doing it with ESA, the European Space Agency, who are friendly with them, and we're beginning to learn a little bit through that avenue, a little bit about what they're doing. Have any of you guys been to China to look at their, I'll let you comment. I just know everybody that I know that has been over there said they were impressed. These guys were good. And of course, when they put their mind to it, I think they can do it.
Yeah, you're right, Gary. I just came back from China. I was there for a week at the Chinese air show working the U.S. pavilion. But I got to know some of the Chinese, and I became very friendly with the guy who's the program manager for the space station that they're going to put up in 2023. I was invited to their space center. But 10 days before we were to go, the U.S. State Department called the guy that I work with and said, you can't go. And I'm confused about that because I could never figure out what harm it would do us if I visited their space center. Now, I can understand a Chinese person coming to visit our space center, they might pick up a few things, but what's going to happen if I go to there? So I am very confused about our attitude about that, but it goes back to the way the U.S. and Russia were kind of butting heads back in the late 60s when those in the space program told us that they'd had a problem and what to do about it. I think the Chinese are the same way. The Chinese taikonauts are just as close to astronauts and cosmonauts as anybody else. They all belong to the Association of Space Explorers, and when there's an annual meeting, they're there, just like everybody else, regardless of what the governments say. And I think that's the thing, that's the glue that holds a lot of these space programs together. And I'll tell you, the Chinese are no slouch. I am firmly convinced they're doing stuff that maybe we can't even do right now because we've not planned for it. But they're very, very good at what they do, and they're very far thinking, which we are not. And I think that's going to be a big, big plus for the Chinese in the long run because they plan way ahead, and we plan a little ahead.
You know, they landed a robotic lander just recently on the far side, which is something we've been talking about doing for a long time. They just did it. And so it's on the far side of the moon. So I think it was Charlie Duke was telling me he did get into their facility. He said you could eat off the floor. He said it was just beautiful, and the hardware was really, really well done.
No, I'd say the thing, from my experience, I worked 4 years on the early Space Station Freedom, it was called at the time. And I was with Grumman at the time, and we won a contract, and I headed up the system engineering integration contract on Space Station. So in that role, I had to work obviously closely with ESA for their Columbia module with the GEM, the Japanese experiment module, Japanese people. Mitsubishi Heavy was mainly who I interfaced with. And of course, Canada with the second arm they built, a robotic arm that's on the space station. And it's clear when you're working that way, unlike I think the hardships we saw working with the Russians on ASTP, you have to have the work done by this mix of people totally separate from the governments, where there's no government political involvement. It's now just a bunch of people that are all primarily engineers that are interested in the overall mission and getting the job done. And that's it has to get to that kind of a climate to do anything cooperative and integrated with, for instance, we're talking about China. You got to have an open kimono, so to speak. I know on ASTP, for a while they were passing written notes back and forth rather than open communication to talk about issues. And you can't operate that way. So it has to be beyond the U.S., the governments involved to say, okay, we condone that this group is now going to go off and take on this task and this mission and get it done. If you don't get to that kind of a climate, it becomes very, very difficult.
But the Chinese have always been, when it comes to intellectually on something, they're sitting at the top, those people that apply themselves. Then there's the political aspect of it. But I see in the last 20, 30 years, the ones that really made progress for their country have been the Chinese in doing this. The decision of where to go and when to do that, that's going to be a political decision. And it's always nice to work together with folks, but both, you know, the Russians, the Chinese, and us, we're not all on the same wavelength for all of these jobs to do it. And there's still kind of competition that goes on to try to make your country look good when you do it. Frankly, I think that the next time that somebody lands on the moon, I think it's probably going to be the Chinese on doing that. Keep in mind, it's been 50 years since the Russians were in competition. Of course, they didn't even admit they were in a competition for at least another 10 years after that. But that's been a long time, and nobody else has been to the moon than us in 50 years.
I think we ought to be cheering the Russians or the Chinese on. They're doing some wonderful things, and I think it's really, in my opinion, it's bad policy for us to be aloof from that, because we're going to miss some of the important things that they're doing and maybe help us along with our own program. I think the Chinese, they've got some fantastic engineers working for them, and you know why they're fantastic? We've trained them. They've all gone to school here in this country, and they all have to go back to China when they finish with their school. They can't stay here. So, in fact, I gave out a scholarship to the University of Michigan. I was telling some people the other day. I gave out a scholarship to a math student to the University of Michigan. There were 100 people in the auditorium, got through with all that, took questions and answers, and the question was, are we going to go back to the moon? And I said, yeah, probably. It's going to be a long time. Well, do you think anybody else will go? And I said, yeah, sure. Who do you think is going to go next? I said, no question about it. The Chinese will be the next people on the moon. The two back rows in the auditorium stood up and cheered. What does that tell you? They're all Chinese.
That's where they were from, yeah.
We're teaching them, yeah, folks. We're teaching them how to do our job.
Well, there is another important fact. We also have to start getting realistic on what it costs to go to Mars. It is going to cost a hell of a lot, believe me. And the technology is going to be very tough to overcome. We can't get there with just what we've solved to go to the moon.
Well, I feel like I'm just getting started, but I think we're pretty close to our time limit. So I just wanted to close with a quote. Years ago, I had the privilege of interviewing Gene Kranz, who was also a flight director during the Apollo and shuttle years. And this was for a History Channel show. So at the end of the interview, when you're doing History Channel shows, you usually say to your interviewee, do you have anything you want to add? And most of the times I go, no, I think we've talked about just about everything I wanted to say. So I asked Gene that question, and he looked down for a moment and thought, and he looked back up at me with that crew cut and those steely missile man eyes of his, and he said, what America will dare, America can do. It gave me chills then, and it still does now, so let's dare again. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Really appreciate it.